Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Thank you for coming today evening. I'm grateful to be here amongst all of you. And today, in the next three classes, today and Saturday and Sunday, I'll speak in three parts on the theme of greater than life's power to hurt is Krishna's power to heal. That will be the broad theme, that life can hurt us in different ways. And when life hurts us, greater than life's power to hurt is Krishna's power to heal. And for this, we need to do something to access Krishna's power to heal. That will be the solution part. And that theme will be, focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. Focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. So I'll talk about this by analyzing three pastimes from the Srimad Bhagavatam. Broadly speaking, if we see in our life, when things go wrong, when life hurts us, the cause can be various. But we can categorize those causes into some broad categories. Sometimes we make some mistake. And it's a small mistake from our part, but there's a catastrophic result from that mistake. So, a friend of mine, he's a traffic cop, and he was telling that he had encountered a case of a boy who was young boy was driving a car, and some local place, some baseball game was going on, and he was watching it on his phone video live streaming, and suddenly something happened and he looked at it, and he had looking at it, and that one moment somehow a child ran across the road. And he was distracted and he knocked down the child. So it is a small distraction, but terrible consequence. So this is what happened to Parikshit Maharaj. A small mistake on his part. He's cursed to die in 7 days. So sometimes, if we have committed a big mistake and we get a proportionate result, still it hurts. But when a small mistake causes a big problem, that is very difficult to bear. The other possibility is that someone else does something which troubles us. And no matter how much we try, that person continues to trouble us. Seems to be on a mission to torment us. And that time, it's extremely difficult to actually get rid of the resentful, revengeful attitude and deal with the situation. So this is what we will analyze in the Gajendra pastime. Gajendra was going along with normal life and suddenly a crocodile caught him. That will be the second session. So one, life may hurt us because of our own small mistake or because of something going wrong, because of someone out there doing something to us. And probably the most difficult to bear when we try to do good to someone, or we try to do something good and that causes problems to us. So if we are trying to do some service and that creates problems, that is, I'm trying to do good. Why are so many problems coming in my life? That is precisely what happened to Prahlad Maharaj. That is what I'll discuss in the Sunday session. Prahlad, for him, all his problems could have been solved if he just gave up his devotion. Normally, people worship God to overcome their problems, to help God to get rid of their problems. It was his devotion to God that caused all his problems. So at that time, when we are trying to do something good and there is nothing wrong on our side at all, at that time when we face problems, to deal with that is extremely difficult. So we'll, in 1 month session, analyze these pastimes and we'll try to draw some lessons for our life from this. So let's begin with the pastime of Parikshit Maharaj. We have heard this pastime many, many times, so I will not go into the details of the pastime, but just some broad features so that we can analyze based on that. Parikshit Maharaj was had gone out into the forest and he got lost and he was tormented by thirst. And when he was tormented by thirst, he came to the house, to the hermitage of a sage. And there he saw this sage was in with closed eyes, sitting erect with closed eyes. Now Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Kim karma kim akarmeti kavayo apyatra mohita. What is action and what is inaction is very difficult to know. Of course, Krishna uses that in the context that what is the action that will lead to bondage and what is the action that will not lead to bondage. That is very difficult to know. But in this case, we can apply that verse that when somebody is in an inactive stage, what stage are they in actually? Say, if we have a family member in our home and they are on their bed lying down. See, their eyes are closed, their breathing is even. Now, how do we know they are asleep or they are awake? You may ask, are you asleep? Now, sometimes that person doesn't want to respond. They may be awake, but still they may not respond. So, now when you are questioning, if you don't get an answer, are you asleep? Now, obviously, if you say, if somebody says, are you asleep? Yes, I am asleep. That would be absurd. So, if somebody doesn't answer, then it is for us to infer. Now, is this person actually sleeping or this person actually simply avoiding me? And in order to avoid me, they are acting as if they are asleep. And quite often, when two possible inferences are there in a particular situation, you know, we infer not so much based on the facts of the situation, but based on our own disposition. You know, if we are angry with that person, if we are annoyed with that person, then we will infer this person is just doing this to irritate me more. So now we may actually be tired and maybe sleeping, but we don't know. So similarly, when the sage was in trance or had closed his eyes, now Parikshit Maharaj made some noise. He just came in, that itself created a noise, and he addressed the sage respectfully. So Shamikrishi did not respond. And now because he had been tormented by thirst so much at that time, that he felt that this sage is neglecting me. It is not so much he misjudged, but his misjudgment was primarily because he was so tormented by thirst. Somehow he wanted some relief. Can you give me some water? That was his request. But the sage did not respond at all. And Parikshit Maharaj got annoyed. And as he walked away in a huff, there was a snake lying nearby. So he just, with his bow, he flipped the snake. And then he was a trained warrior. So he just flipped the snake in such a way that it went and fell as a garland on the sage. It's a dead snake. And it was just a sarcastic gesture. He says, you know, you didn't offer me a garland, but I'll offer you a garland. And then he walked away from there. And when he walked away, as he went back to his palace and he drank some water, got relief. And as soon as that pressure was relieved, immediately his intelligence started working. Sometimes the sheer pressure of some physical need can agitate us so much that we can't think much about it. So he said, what if that sage was really meditating? If that were the case, I have committed a great offense. I shouldn't have done like this. It was terrible of me. It was extremely uncharacteristic of Parikshit Maharaj to do such a thing. You know, actually, just a few chapters before, this is the 18th and 19th chapters of the Srimad Bhagavatam, the first canto. 16th and 17th chapters describe how Parikshit Maharaj is so vigilant in protecting Brahminical culture that when he heard that Kali has started acting in his kingdom, the malefic influence of this dark age has started. So he went out to vigilantly look if there are any influences and to check those influences. And when he saw Kali personified in the form of a man wearing a king's robes, tormenting a cow and a bull, he strongly punished Kali. So a person who was so careful even in protecting cows, that person would not offend a Brahmana. But it was circumstantially, under the pressure of the situation, he did that. And the result of that was Sringi, his son, Shamikrishi's son, saw it by his mystic vision. He got angry. And he said that these Kshatriyas, what do they think they are? So generally, what happens when we get power, we tend to become intoxicated by our power. So he said, these Kshatriyas, who are they? They're just meant to be doorkeepers at our house. They're meant to be the protectors. We are the Brahmanas. How dare he offend my father like this? And he started thinking, if you hear his words, the way he thinks is amazing. He thinks that, does this upstart king think that just because Krishna has departed from the world, there is no one to protect Dharma? He says, I am there to protect Dharma. So when he curses Parikshit, he actually thinks that I am doing God's work. He thinks that I am establishing and protecting Dharma. So actually, especially when we are doing something which is harmful to someone else, to think that I am doing God's work is actually very dangerous. It's a very self-righteous way in which you can rationalize terribly wrong things. So he said, when he started thinking, I am doing God's work, and he cursed Parikshit Maharaj to die in 7 days. This was a horrendous curse to give. When Parikshit Maharaj heard about this, and Shamik Rishi came to know about it, and then Shamik Rishi, he is distressed. He says, what have you done? This king is our protector. He is the protector of Dharma. He is a great devotee. What is this small mistake? When he came back to his consciousness, external consciousness, he saw the snake, he flipped it away. Didn't even notice it, didn't care for it. And then his son told what had happened, he was shocked. And then he immediately sent a messenger to the king. Now at this point, Parikshit Maharaj had every reason to be outraged. Yes, he had made a mistake. But one basic principle in justice is that when justice is to be done, the punishment should be proportional to the wrongdoing, not proportional to the outrage felt about the wrongdoing. All of us, when something wrong happens to us, we get angry. And especially somebody is a victim or somebody is close to the victim, they can get furious about it. We understand their outrage, but their outrage cannot be the basis for corrective action. It has to be in proportion to the crime. So to condemn someone to die just for a minor indiscretion, that is outrageous. And when this happened, Parikshit Maharaj, he could have become resentful, he could have become revengeful, but he did not. It's interesting that after the 18th chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, Sringi doesn't appear even once. Parikshit Maharaj, throughout his Bhagavatam, when he's speaking, he speaks, I'm fasting, let that snake bird come upon me. He speaks words like that, but he never once even mentions Sringi. Doesn't blame him at all. He also, not only does he not blame Sringi, he does not blame himself also. Afterwards, he's not beating himself up thinking, why did I do such a stupid thing? Why did I have to curse him? Because of that, now I have to die. He doesn't do either. The mistake has happened, he acknowledges the mistake and he says, you know, he considers it to be a very serious mistake on his part. He says, whatever reaction is to come, let it come upon me immediately. But once he's focused on taking shelter of the Srimad Bhagavatam by hearing it from Parikshit Goswami, he doesn't at all think about the past. So he just lets it go. Now this has two broad points for us. One is that when we do a mistake, and then that mistake leads to a chain of events, and then somehow that small mistake leads to a catastrophic result. So at that time, we have to see that actually, as mind beats us up, mind can beat us up in two ways. You know, why did I do that? We may beat ourselves up because of that, or we may resent. Why did all this happen to me? Why did this small thing? Why should it lead to a big thing? Now both ways, the philosophy of the Bhagavatam can help us to deal with. The first, let's look at the second point first. That why did some small mistake have to lead to some terrible consequences? We often say that the law of karma is that to every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. But there are many times when you see that actually it is not an equal reaction. It seems to be a far greater reaction. Sometimes, you know, we speak one harsh word to someone, and that person becomes so angry with us, that person goes on a tantrum, and then that person creates so many, tells so many people, you know, this person did like this to me, this person spoke this to me, this person spoke this to me. It's a small mistake, why such a big reaction? So sometimes it appears as if karma doesn't seem to be acting. It's like small mistake is leading to a huge reaction. So here is where the Bhagavatam brings in the concept of Daiva. Daiva is destiny. So when we say that by the principle of karma, to every action there is an equal and opposite reaction. Actually, that's the Newton's law of karma. But we could broadly say that
Newton's law of karma, okay. Newton's law of motion, sorry. Okay. That's called a malapropism, where you mix two words together. So there was once an initiation ceremony. The devotee was so nervous. He says, so no, before I take the vow, no gambling, no intoxication, no illicit sex, and no eat meeting.
So now, when this king, when a reaction comes upon us, actually, daiva or destiny also plays a role. So normally we think of the law of karma as this is the action and this is the result of the action. And this is a extremely simplified understanding of karma. The basic understanding of karma is that every cause leads to an effect and every effect has a cause. But it is not that the cause that we produce and the effect that we get, there may not be a linear correlation between the two. Why not? That is because karma is a complicated thing. Gahana karmano gati. It is, as Krishna said in the Bhagavad Gita, it's very difficult to understand. So the way the action leads to a result is that there are some factors involved in it. Karma plus daiva plus kala leads to phala. Phala is the fruit, what we get. Karma is the action that we do. So normally, when I think that, okay, I put my hand in fire, my hand burns. That is, did the action, I got the reaction. I got the result of it. Yeah, sometimes it might just be straightforward. But more often than not, it is not so straightforward. There is karma here and there is phala here. But just karma alone doesn't determine the phala. Action alone doesn't determine the result. From karma, along with karma, there is daiva. That is destiny. And then there is kala. That is time. So karma, daiva and kala, when all three come together, that leads to phala. That leads to the result. So two simple examples to illustrate this, and then we'll apply it to our life. One is, say a farmer is plowing the land and sowing the seeds. that is karma. The rains coming on time in the right quantity, that is daiva. And then the season changing to the harvest chasing season, that is kala. And karma, daiva, kala will lead to phala. Sometimes the farmer may plow, but still, if the rains don't come, there will be no result. Or the Bhagavad Gita in the 6th canto gives the example in Chittaketu pastime of how a couple, when they get married, they may want to have a child. Now they may unite, that is the karma. But sometimes despite union, some conception doesn't happen. So there's some higher power involved over there. So that is what is daiva. And then even if conception has happened, you know, the child doesn't come immediately. There's the gestation period. So karma, daiva, kala leads to phala. All three when they come together, that leads to phala. So now the kala element is variable. Something may require little time, something may require a lot of time. So for us, actually speaking, daiva and kala are not always visible. So all that we see is, I have done the karma and I have got the phala. But in between, a lot is going on. So Prabhupada writes in the first canto that when things are beyond human control, there is nothing to regret. When things are beyond human control, we did what we could, and despite that, things went wrong, then there is nothing to regret for us. Oh, it's just, that means that we understand that time, daiva is not favorable. Destiny is at that time acting in an unfavorable way. So if we obsess over the fact, why this small thing, why did such a big result come out because of that? Big problem come up because of that. It is not just because of that small action. That small action was just like the trigger. But after that trigger, actually suppose say somebody has a gun and they press the gun, they press the trigger, then a bullet shoots out. Now something might be a toy gun from which just some toy bullet comes out. Something might be a stun gun which just stuns the person, which shocks the person. Something might be a real gun which wounds or kills the person. Now in all the cases the trigger has to be pressed. But after the trigger is pressed, what will be the result? That depends on what is there in the gun. What is the nature of the gun and what is there in the gun. So, what is for us, our karma is like pressing the trigger. But after we press the trigger, we don't know what is there in the gun. The bullet in the gun is like the destiny. So, sometimes we might, some event might happen, we might make a mistake. And actually, it doesn't lead to much result. You just make some mistake, but nothing goes wrong, nobody catches us, life just goes on. But that means that the trigger was there, but it was like a toy gun over there. But sometimes, some child may pick up and just while playing, press a button, gun, trigger. Child doesn't even know what I'm doing. And then, boom, a big noise comes up, and then a terrible thing can happen because of that. So for us, the action that we are doing is simply like the trigger. It is, yes, it is definitely a part of the causal chain, but it is not the sole cause. And therefore, yes, we may say when we are pressing a trigger, we should be careful. You know, what is there in the gun, we don't know. But the point is that even if we are careful, sometimes a small mistake might lead to a big, big catastrophic result. So when daiva is unfavorable, at that time, if factors beyond our control lead to something bad happening, it is just for us to accept it. Now, how do we accept it? It's something terrible that has happened. In general, for us, in every situation in life, something is in our control and something is beyond our control. So we can do the best that we can in what is in our control. But what is beyond our control, the more we obsess over it, the more we disempower ourselves. Bhaktisiddhanta Swami Thakur says that bhakti frees the soul from the burden of being the controller of the world.
So, normally we think being controlled is a powerful thing. I can control things. But actually we can't control. And trying to control is like a burden for us. So when we practice bhakti, bhakti yoga, it frees us. I am not the controller. I am a servant. So let me serve the best way I can. So this accepting daiva is not easy in general. But it is possible when we understand I am a servant. In this situation I am trying to serve, and in that situation also I am trying to serve. If things had turned out this way, I would have served in this way. Now things are turned that way, so I will serve in that way. Now what is the relationship between daiva and Krishna? Is daiva the same as Krishna? Is destiny the same as God or Krishna? Yes and no. Our philosophy is of achintya bheda bhed. So, normally speaking, when we consider destiny, okay, let me get to a pastime and then I'll come back to this analysis. So, in the Mahabharata, when Bhishma falls on the 10th day, at that time, everybody expects that now Karna is going to come into the battlefield. Karna had been off the battlefield because he was offended by Bhishma's assessment of his power. So when Karna came back, because of the close friendship between Duryodhana and Karna, everybody expected Karna would become the commander. And that's what Duryodhana offered Karna. But Karna said no. He said, there are many warriors senior to me over here, and Drona is like my guru. Drona is the guru of all of you, so offer him the commandership. Now when Drona was offered the commandership, he was very pleasantly surprised. And he said, he was thinking that he would have to serve under Karna, which would be difficult for him. So, he was pleased. He said, okay, Prince, you have pleased me. Ask for some boon. And then, Duryodhana was ready. So, he's a politician. Politicians are opportunists. And then there are, as they say, there are no free lunches. So, when he was doing this, he had an agenda. So, he said, please arrest Yudhishthir and bring him in front of me alive as a prisoner. So, Drona's eyes opened wide and he said, oh. So, Yudhishthir is such an ajata shatru that you don't want, even you don't want to kill him. So, Duryodhana said, after seeing this battle going on for 10 days, seeing the power of Arjuna and Bhima, I have concluded that we cannot win this war. If we kill Yudhishthir, Arjuna and Bhima will go mad in anger and they will destroy us. So, my plan is, if you arrest Yudhishthir and bring him in front of me, I will challenge him for another gambling match. And I will send him to forest for another 13 years. And during that time, I will consolidate my strength. So Drona said, you will never learn. He didn't say that, he thought like that. But then, Drona said that, I will do what you want me to do, but I have a condition. Is keep Arjuna out of my way. Although Arjuna is my student, I have taught him everything that I know. And he has done austerity and learned, I have got mystic powers, and he is younger than me. So if he comes in the way, I will not be able to reach Yudhishthir. So then they try to sidetrack Arjuna. And on 11th and 12th, both days, Yudhishthir is almost arrested by Drona. But Arjuna, both times, Arjuna has been sidetracked. Arjuna comes back in time and saves the day. And on the 12th night, Duryodhana is furious because he had engaged a lot of warriors to sidetrack Arjuna. They are the Trigartha warriors whom he had got to fight. Arjuna destroyed legions of those warriors and still he came back and saved Yudhishthir. He said, you saved Yudhishthir. So he says, oh Acharya, you had promised that you would arrest Yudhishthir. It is only because you are affectionate to the Pandavas that you are not fighting wholeheartedly. And he knew how to, see those are politicians, they know how to flatter and they know how to infuriate also. So, Chanakya Pandit says that if you want to become a king of the world, more than the power of fighting with a sword, you need to have the power of words. How to speak the right words at the right time. So here he spoke, if you are not going to fight wholeheartedly for me, kindly step down and Karna will become the commander and he will lead me to victory. This was infuriating. For I said, oh prince, you hurt those who have dedicated to your cause. You see my body, it is lacerated with wounds right now, which I have gone through simply to work for you. I promised you that I will arrest Yudhishthir and I have endeavored to the best of my capacity. But only endeavor is in the hands of human beings. The result is determined by destiny. And the Lord of destiny is seated on the chariot of Krishna, Arjuna. So what can we do? So he describes Krishna not as destiny but as the Lord of destiny. What does it mean? At one level we could say that destiny is a material mechanism, that daiva is a material mechanism. So I talk about karma, daiva and kala leads to phala. Now what exactly is daiva? What is destiny? We could consider it to be like a water tank. In the water tank, there is one area from which the water is flowing inside and another area from which the water is flowing outside. So the the actions that we are doing right now, that is like the water flow, if we consider that water tank to be like our accumulation of karma, the total accumulation of karma that we have, that is like the destiny. And the actions that we are doing right now, that's like the water flowing inside. That is called the agami karma, the karma that we are doing right now, it's going on. And then there is some water coming out from the outlet. And that water is the results that we are experiencing. That is prarabdha and aprarabdha karma, we could say. So now, here we often think, I am putting this water here, that is the water I should get out from there. But it's not like that. Now this you could say the destiny tank is a complicated tank. What does it mean? It's like, imagine inside this tank, it's filled with many pipelines. And sometimes, you know, water comes in from here and there is some kind of like you have a revolving door, like that's a shutter. So imagine there are 5-6 different pipes inside. So one pipe is such that this water goes straight from here and comes out over here. Some is that the water goes here and the pipe which goes up and down, and maybe after a few hours or after some time the water comes out. And then the other pipe which just goes round and round and round and round for a long time. And then finally that water comes out over here. So the water is going in, it will come out. But which water will come out when, we don't know. So sometimes we may do something wrong and we may get the result immediately also. If I suddenly approach one of you and slap you, he says, why did you slap me? It's your own destiny. So I'm just simply an instrument for giving you your destiny, your past karma, and you will slap me back. I'm an instrument for your destiny. So now if we slap someone, that person will get angry and slap us back. That could be a straightforward reaction. If the immediate cause-effect correlation can be seen, then there is no need to look for a remote cause-effect correlation. If a person calls a doctor early in the morning, doctor, my stomach is upset. Doctor, first question doctor will ask is, what did you eat last night? Isn't it? Now, sometimes that person may have eaten a perfectly normal diet and still their stomach is upset. If they have eaten something excessively or inappropriately, then at that time there is no need to look for some past karma. This is your recent karma only. That is the result. But sometimes the result may not be proportional to the karma that has been done. I'd say nowadays there is a great concern that we may become if we eat too much, we become obese. So now there are some people who are genetically, they are genetically prone to be obese. So some people, even if they eat a little extra, they tend to become very fat. Some people, they treat their tongue like a conveyor belt. And still nothing happens. they stay fit and healthy and it just, they stay normal. So basically, the exact correlation between action and reaction is difficult to know. So if we can find the immediate correlation, well and good. So okay, my stomach is upset because I ate this. But sometimes I'm eating normally and still my stomach may get upset. So this daiva, what comes to us? This is the material mechanism. This is just water coming in from here. There are multiple pipelines over there. And which water will come out, we don't know. But there is a material mechanism for that. And in that sense, we could say at one level, Krishna is not involved in it. It's simply the law of karma. So if somebody jumps down from a 10-story building, no, they may forget gravity, but gravity won't forget them. Now, if somebody has jumped down from a 10-story building, it is not that Krishna caused the accident. It is, yes, you could say gravity took over after they got off from the building, but it is they are responsible. So now the law of gravity, ultimately we can say all laws are under Krishna's will. So in that sense, that we could say even destiny, when it manifests something, it is Krishna's will. But destiny at one level is a material mechanism, which has been arranged by Krishna, but Krishna is not necessarily directly involved in it. At another level, a devotee tries to see the hand of Krishna everywhere. So when I said now the water goes in from here, and then some water comes out from here. So from here, when the water goes in, the inlet, which pipe it will go into? And at the outlet, which pipe will open up? This is not determined arbitrarily. To us, it may appear arbitrary. But actually, it's not arbitrary. It is determined by ultimately by what is best for us. So in that sense, destiny is not just the neutral mechanism. Destiny is also arranged in such a way by the super soul and ultimately by Krishna for our growth, for our well-being. So even if we do some honest take and a big terrible catastrophic result comes because of that, that circumstantially appears to be terrible, but from the ultimate perspective, there is all that is happening is meant for our spiritual growth. All that is happening is meant for us to evolve spiritually. So when we understand that some things result because of destiny, then what happens? We can shift our attention from why did this happen, or even why did I do this, to okay, how can I serve Krishna now? To some extent, we always need to use our intelligence to make sense of things. But there are some times when we just can't make sense of things. Now, why did this have to happen? When we can't make sense of things, at that time, it is best to change the question that we are asking. Instead of asking why this, we change the why question to the how question. How now? How now means, okay, how can I serve Krishna now? Why did this happen? We can and you should use our intelligence to try to understand things. But sometimes it just doesn't make sense. So at that time, just shift. How can I serve Krishna now? How can I serve Krishna now? And that is the question that will empower us. Harping on the question, why this, why this, why this? If you are not getting any explanation, then it is best to avoid that question. And just move on. Move on. It's
It says, actually, humility is expressed in different ways. One is when we come in from the deities and bow down to the deities. That is the expression of humility in a physical way, physically. At an intellectual level, humility is expressed through the acknowledgement that I don't know and maybe I can't know. We have a need for knowledge, that is true, but sometimes just I don't know, I can't know. That's the only way we can move forward at that time. We just have to accept it. When we accept this, okay, I don't know why this is happening. And if I just keep asking this question, why? It is just like our consciousness goes on a channel that is blocked. It's blocked, we just can't move on. It just takes us nowhere. So better change the question to how. The why question keeps our consciousness going around and round in a circle where we get nothing productive out of it. It's like a fan. Fan moves round and round and round. Now when the fan moves round and round, at least it cools us down. But when our mind moves round and round and round, it heats us up. So sometimes the why question is just frustrating. So Parikshit Maharaj did not get into this. Why did this happen? Okay, just accepted it. It's happened now. Now why did Sringi have to curse me? Or why did I have to put that garland? Okay, it's happened now. Let's move on. So how can I serve Krishna right now? Came to know that I'm cursed, I'm to die in 7 days. His whole life was devoted to Krishna. But then he decided, now I want to devote myself exclusively to Krishna. So there is inclusive devotion and there is exclusive devotion. Exclusive devotion means we focus. They say we come to the temple and hear about Krishna, we worship the deities, we chant the holy names, we do kirtan. That is exclusive devotion. Now here I am using the word exclusive in a slightly different sense. Often we use the word exclusive in the sense that be devoted only to Krishna and not to any other devata or any other, no demigod and no semi-god. What is he? God. Oh. I am God. there are many teachers who claim that I am God. There was a Swami who had come from India. He came and said that many gurus have come in the past and they have told you that they are God. He says, I have not come for that purpose. I have come for a selfless purpose. My purpose is not to tell you I am God. My purpose is to tell you are God. So there are normally we use the word exclusive devotion in the sense that what is the object of devotion is one, but I am using the word exclusive devotion not to refer to the object but to the method of practice, that we just focus directly on devotional activities. Inclusive devotion means we do variety of activities for Krishna in which directly Krishna may not be the center of the focus. Say for example, if we are doing management of a temple, at that time we have to think of so many things, okay, how to do this, how to do that, how to get that done. At that time we are doing it for Krishna, but Krishna may not be the forefront of our consciousness. If we are doing our jobs, taking care of our family, we are doing it all for Krishna. So, and the process of bhakti is so inclusive that it includes it. But that time Krishna is not at the forefront of our consciousness. So unless we have some time for exclusive devotion, you know, we cannot do inclusive devotion. Because unless we connect directly with Krishna, then we will not be able to connect indirectly with Krishna. And normally our life has to alternate between exclusive devotion and inclusive devotion. We need some time for directly connecting with Krishna. And then the remaining time we do our various activities in the service of Krishna. But when there's a crisis, or especially when the final moment comes in life, then we have to shift from that inclusive devotion to exclusive devotion. It is said about Bhishma Pitama that when he instructed Maharaj Yudhishthir in the Raja Dharma, after that, the Bhagavatam says that person who had spoken on hundreds of subjects and fought hundreds of wars. Then he withdrew his consciousness and fixed it wholeheartedly on Krishna. And then the prayers that he offers to Krishna are described. Iti matir upakalpita vitrishna. So he offers his whole heart to Krishna. Similarly, for Parikshit Maharaj also, his life was always devoted to Krishna. But as a king, he had to think of so many things to manage and to rule. But then when he realized I'm going to die in 7 days, he installed his son Janmeja as the king, and then he went to Ganga's bank to practice exclusive devotion, to just wholeheartedly hear about Krishna. Gayanti Vishnu Gatha, he says. Tammo payatam payatyantu Vishnu. He says, whatever this curse has led, whatever that magical snake bird, whatever it may come, oh sages, you just sing about the glories of Vishnu. It's significant here that normally we hear that the sages were, when Parikshit Maharaj asked them, what is the dharma? What should I do at the time of death? And the sages were confused, and then finally Shukadeva Goswami came, and then Shukadeva Goswami spoke that you should glorify Krishna. Now, but before that itself, Parikshit Maharaj actually says, please sing the glories of Gayanti Vishnu Gatha. Please sing the glories of Vishnu. So Parikshit Maharaj is a devotee, and by nature his heart is devoted to Krishna. So when he comes to the banks of the Jamuna, banks of the Ganga, at that time, he is devoted. He wants to be devoted to Krishna. He wants to hear about Krishna's glories only. But out of deference to the sages, and in order to reveal the glory of hearing about Krishna, he says, oh sages, you tell me, what is the best thing to do? And then he asks Parikshit Maharaj also about it. And Parikshit Maharaj says, Tasmad Bharat Sarvatma Bhagavan Ishwaro Harihi Shrotavya Kirtitavyascha Smartavyascha Ichchatabhayam. One who wants to be fearless, let them hear, chant, remember and worship Lord Hari. So Parikshit Maharaj does not get into the zone of blaming anyone or even blaming himself. He just moves forwards towards wholehearted, exclusive devotional absorption in Krishna. So one aspect I was talking about till now is that when something happens which just doesn't make sense to us, we try to make sense, but if we can't, then just shift the question from why to how. Not why is this happening, but how can I serve now? And once we shift this, we'll find there are still ways in which I can serve, ways in which I can continue, ways in which I can move forward in my life. So life sometimes hurts us in terrible ways. And we focus on the hurt, then we just can't move forwards. But if we focus on, okay, how can I serve now? Then we can move forwards. So we can't always be grateful for all situations, but we can be grateful in all situations. For all situations means this bad thing has happened, we should be grateful for that. That is often very difficult. Something terrible has happened. If somebody loses their job, somebody loses a loved one, somebody gets a terrible terminal disease, it's a bad thing. It's very difficult, and it's sometimes unhealthy also to try to somehow do some mental juggling to think that this is good. Okay, if we're trying to do that, we'll just be unrealistic for us. We accept it is bad, but what is good in my life? Okay, I got this terrible disease, but my overall health is good. I have a supportive family, I have a supportive community, I've got health insurance, the disease is curable. Let me start taking the treatment. So we can shift our focus to what is right in our life. We can't be grateful for all situations, but we can be grateful in all situations by shifting our focus to what is right, not what is wrong. And that brings us back to the theme that focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. That there is Krishna's plan acting somehow, and if we just persevere in trying to serve him, we will be able to move forwards. The other lesson which draws is that Parikshit Maharaj did not beat himself up also with this. He did not beat himself up saying that, why did I do this? Actually, sometimes when people do wrong to us, we need to forgive them. And I'll talk about forgiveness in the next session. But an equally important part is that if we commit a mistake, we also need to forgive ourselves. No. We need to, if we are to give ourselves to Krishna, we need to forgive ourselves first. We need to forgive ourselves to give ourselves to Krishna. Why do we need to forgive ourselves? Because we are the only resource we have. We are the only resource we have. Even if we have to take Krishna's shelter, it is we who have to take Krishna's shelter. If we become so disheartened that we can't do anything, then we won't be able to take shelter of Krishna also. So suppose, say we have an old car which doesn't work well, we just goes very slowly, makes strange noises, stops working in between. Now we may be exasperated with it. But if we are exasperated with it, and if in a fit of anger, we take a big boulder and break that car itself, then we will be left with nothing. So if that is the only car we have, then that is the car we have to use. So similarly for us, if we keep beating ourselves up too much, then we can't offer ourselves to Krishna. Yes, we want to become purified. We have all imperfections, we have impurities, but it is, we have to offer ourselves to Krishna. So there are two aspects to this. It is we who have to do the offering, and it is we who are also the offering. It is we who have to offer, and it is we who are what is to be offered to Krishna. Krishna wants not just the results of our service, Krishna wants us to offer our heart. So, if we are very weak, if we are very injured, if we are very disheartened, then we won't have the energy to offer ourselves to Krishna also. And even what will be offered will be filled with so much negativity. That is not a worthy offering to Krishna. Yes, we want to feel humble, and humility comes by acknowledging, yes, I have made many mistakes in the past. I am fallen, I am sinful. That's all that is. Yes, it is required so that we feel the need for Krishna. But unless we forgive ourselves, that refusal to forgive ourselves can come as a block between us and Krishna. So, if somebody feels, I have not done anything wrong at all, well, that attitude is also a problem. We all have committed many mistakes. It said that we are all very fallen. And if we don't think we are fallen, then we are really fallen. So it's like a drunk person. When a person is a little drunk, they understand, you know, hey, I'm drunk now, I drank too much. I should not drive a car now. Maybe I'll ask somebody else to drive. And they ask for help when they're a little drunk. But when they're heavily drunk, they say, you know, somebody tells them, you should not drive around. Why should not I drive? So, when they're so heavily drunk, they don't even understand they're drunk. So like that, sometimes we'll be so drunk with ego that we don't think we are at all having any problems. So then, if we don't think we are fallen, we are really fallen. But to not forgive ourselves means we accept that we are fallen and then we stay fallen. We don't get up only. So disheartened, we say, I can't do anything. Say, okay, I'm fallen, but by Krishna's mercy, I can rise. So to forgive ourselves means to recognize that, okay, whatever mistakes I may have committed, Krishna is still with me. Krishna is still my Lord. Krishna is still my guide. And Krishna will help me. So this is a theme which I will discuss elaborately in the last session about, you know, how Krishna's plan works. Even through our mistakes, even if we have committed some mistakes, even if we have done something right, we have done something wrong, through it all, Krishna's plan is always acting. Mm. And sometimes our mind may say, you know, this is such a terrible mistake. Everything is lost. No, nothing can happen right. Actually, if we say, I have committed such a big mistake that Krishna's plan can't work now.
That means we are giving too much credit to ourselves, actually, in a perverse sense. We are very tiny beings. We cannot stop or foil Krishna's plan. Krishna's plan can act in spite of our mistakes, or sometimes even through our mistakes. Our mistakes have consequences, no doubt. I'll first speak on this later, but I'll give one example here to conclude. That, so suppose we are driving to a destination and we have GPS guiding us, and the GPS says turn right, and then we turn left. Now when we turn left, the GPS says get lost now. The GPS doesn't do that. What does the GPS do? It reroutes immediately. It reroutes and then tells, okay, now you take this turn, now you come back. Now if it says now you turn right over here, again if you turn left, what happens? Again the GPS reroutes. No matter how many wrong turns we take, the GPS will reroute and shows the way from there. Now this doesn't mean that the wrong turns are inconsequential. Each wrong turn will mean that it will take that much time for us to get to the destination. So the wrong turn definitely is consequential. It is, but it is not fatal. It has consequences, but no matter how many wrong turns we may take, there is always a path from there back to the destination. Similarly, Krishna is like the ultimate GPS. He is always there with us in our hearts, guiding us. Ishvara sarva bhutana riddeshe arjuna tishtati. Brahmayan sarva bhutani yantra rudhani maya. We are situated in this yantra, the body, and he is Brahmayan, he is guiding our wanderings, he is directing our wanderings. So no matter how many mistakes we make, Krishna has a plan, and Krishna's plan accommodates our mistakes. Krishna doesn't want us to make mistakes. It is, mistakes are mistakes. You don't think that mistakes are not mistakes. We acknowledge it is a mistake, but we don't have to become disheartened to say that, okay, there is a path from here, let me take this path and I can reach my destination. So forgiving ourselves doesn't mean that we deny the mistakes that we have committed. It just means that we stop beating ourselves up because of the mistakes. We shift our attention, okay, this mistake has happened, I'm responsible for it, but now how can I move forwards in my life? There's a difference between taking responsibility and blaming oneself. Taking responsibility is analytical acknowledgement. Okay, I should have acted like this, but I acted like this. But blaming ourselves means we just keep beating ourselves up. Why did I do that? What a fool I am. I'm useless. That is of no use. So taking responsibility is important for us, so that in future we will act more responsibly and wisely. But blaming ourselves stops us from taking responsibility. So in that sense, taking responsibility and blaming ourselves are not just different, they can be opposite. Taking our responsibility helps us to make the right choice, whereas blaming ourselves keeps us from the right choice. And thus, what happened with Parikshit Maharaj was that despite his incidental mistake, despite the terrible curse that resulted from that mistake, through it all he took shelter of Krishna. And by that shelter of Krishna, not only was he blessed, but posterity was blessed by that. Because Shukadeva Goswami spoke the Srimad Bhagavatam. And thus, Parikshit Maharaj demonstrates to us, as the central character of the Bhagavatam, that it was terrible wrong that happened to him. That it was for a small mistake, it was such a big consequence. But he took shelter of Krishna. I said that greater than life's power to hurt is Krishna's power to heal. So rather than focusing on the hurt, he shifted to the healing power of Krishna. He turned towards absorbing himself in Krishna. Madashraya katha amrishta shunvanti kathayanti cha tapanti vividhastapa naitan madgata chetasaha. The Bhagavatam says, the third canto of the Kapila's teachings, they say that those devotees who take shelter of me, madashraya, how do they take shelter? Katha amrishta, by hearing my delightful pastimes.
Shunvanti kathayanti cha. They hear it, they speak it. What happens by this? Tapanti vividhastapa. The various distresses of life will come, but naitan matkata chetasaha. They will not torment the devotee, because the devotee's consciousness is absorbed in Krishna. So this is the mood of the Bhagavatam, that no matter how life may hurt us, if we try to seek shelter of Krishna, we absorb ourselves in Krishna, then we can overcome whatever difficulty life may send our way. I'll summarize. I spoke on the theme of focus not greater than life's power to hurt is Krishna's power to heal, and focus not on the wrongdoer, focus on the ultimate doer. I took these two themes, and in today's class I spoke on when a small mistake leads to a terrible result, how do we deal with it. So Parikshit Maharaj was a small mistake of under the pressure of the urge for water, thirst for water, he cursed, he garlanded Shringi Vishwamitra with a snake, and he was cursed to die in 7 days. Punishment has to be proportionate to the crime, not to the outrage felt to the crime. So that's why it was disproportionate. But what did he do? He took shelter of Krishna. He did not beat himself up for the wrongdoing, nor did he resent, why was this happening to me? So we discussed about how we normally think that action leads to the reaction or the result. This can happen, but there is much more over there. There is karma and phala, but in between what is there? Daiva and kala, yes. So the farming as well as the procreating example. And then I talked about how karma and phala, they are related in a complex way. In between, we could say there is a water tank with an inlet and outlet. But from the inlet to outlet, there can be multiple connections. Some are direct, some are winding, and some may be hugely winding. So for us, we just do action and we get a result, and we think this has produced this. But when destiny is unfavorable, then our small mistake, a small negative action, that leads to a big reaction, because our action becomes like a trigger. So when we press a trigger, at that time, depending on what is the nature of the gun and the bullet within it, it might be harmless, it might hurt slightly, or it might hurt fatally. So similarly, our action is like the trigger, and depending on destiny, the results may vary. And then I discuss about the relationship with destiny and Krishna through the pastime of Drona and Duryodhana trying to arrest Yudhishthir, that Krishna is the lord of destiny. So at one level, destiny is like a material mechanism, like the principle of law of gravity. As whatever actions we do, we get the results. But at another level, we understand everything happens by Krishna's will. So as devotees, we see that even if it's destiny acting, it is acting for my ultimate good. And we see how we can take shelter of Krishna more. So we try to look for the correlation between action and result as much as possible. That is the use of our intelligence in Krishna's service. But we need our intelligence in Krishna's service, we also need humility. And humility means to acknowledge sometimes that I don't know and I can't know. So when we don't get answer, when things don't make sense, then we change the question from why to how. Not why is this happening, but how can I serve now? And once we shift, we'll find there are opportunities to serve always. Even if we can't be grateful for all situations, we can be grateful in all situations by looking at what are the opportunities for us to serve Krishna in that situation. So Parikshit Maharaj was practicing inclusive devotion when he was a king, but when he was cursed, then he started focusing on exclusive devotion. Completely focused only on hearing about Krishna. So this way we can make sense to some extent when small mistake leads to a terrible result. Rather than blaming some unfair destiny, we see it as ultimately meant for our good. And we don't blame ourselves and beat ourselves down also, because we understand that we need to forgive ourselves to give ourselves to Krishna. We are our only resource. So if we beat ourselves up, then we have nothing. We won't be able to offer anything to Krishna. We are the offering, and we are the one who is meant to give the offering also. So therefore, blaming ourselves means continuously beating ourselves up. Accepting responsibility means acknowledging and then correcting ourselves. Even if we have committed mistakes,
Krishna is still our Lord and guide. Krishna is like the ultimate GPS. No matter how many wrong turns we take, he's still there to reroute and get us to the destination. By focusing on Krishna and how we can serve Krishna, we can find our way even through darkness, even through difficulties, even through mistakes, to ultimately attain his shelter. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions or comments? Yes, please.
When Sringi cursed Maharaj Parikshit, there was a moment, wasn't there, when someone could reverse the curse, but Maharaj Parikshit said not to reverse the curse?
When Sringi cursed, was there a moment when he could have reversed it, but Parikshit Maharaj chose not to reverse?
Or could his father reverse the curse?
Yes. I don't know about his father. The Bhagavatam does say that there is a verse which says that even when a devotee is injured or devotee is offended, the devotee can retaliate, but the devotee does not retaliate. So now, I have never heard as far whether Parikshit Maharaj had the power to counter curse, but whether the Parikshit Maharaj had the power to counter the curse and he chose not to, because he is a great devotee, so he may have had that power, but he did not exercise that power at that particular point. It doesn't seem that either Sringi did not have the power to withdraw the curse. The Bhagavatam often says that words are like arrows. Once they are shot from the they are taken out of the arrow sheath and they are shot, they cannot be taken back. So, there are some situations in which the effect of curses can be reduced or they can be mitigated in some way. But generally, curses are considered quite serious. Once it's spoken, it's spoken. So, Parikshit Maharaj could have countered it, but at that particular point, he chose that this is the will of the Lord for me to take shelter of the Lord, shelter of Vishnu. So that's how it is described in the Bhagavatam. The Mahabharata describes it slightly differently. The Mahabharata's mood is of establishing dharma in the world. So the Mahabharata, at least the version of the Mahabharata that we have, it describes quite a different Parikshit. So it's possibly from a different yuga. It describes how Parikshit makes various arrangements to protect himself from the curse. So he goes into a fort and he stays in that fort for a long time. Stays in the fort completely protected so that nobody will be able to get to him. But then the sage comes to him and offers him a fruit. And he thinks this is a sage. He gives the fruit, and as he opens the fruit, a snake appears out of it and snake stings him and then he dies. So now there, Parikshit Maharaj does try to mitigate the curse, try to protect himself from the curse. Madhvacharya has said that the Mahabharata that we have, that was present at his time, which he says that itself was, it was such a big book, he says that there are many interpolations in it. So generally our acharyas are focused on the Bhagavatam. If the Bhagavatam and the Mahabharata contradict, then we focus on the Bhagavatam, because the Bhagavatam has been preserved in our tradition specifically. The Bhagavatam has had many commentaries. So where the commentators have commented, the followers of the commentators have preserved that book. The Mahabharata is so big that it practically has no commentary. There's only one commentary, which is also not a detailed commentary. But even that version of the story can also be seen in a devotional way. That sometimes a devotee may, when they are faced with a problem, they may choose to mitigate the problem. They may choose to retaliate and deal with the problem, not retaliate exactly, but to counter the problem. Sometimes the devotee may accept it as the will of the Lord, and sometimes the devotee may see that the will of the Lord is that I fight.
Could you
Yeah, sorry. Thank you.
Say suppose a devotee gets cancer. Now some devotees may feel that, okay, and now I've lived my life, it's old, I just accept this as the will of the Lord and I'll focus myself on devoting myself to Krishna. Some other devotee feel, no, I have a lot of more service to do for Krishna, so I'll fight the cancer. And if that doesn't work, then the devotee will also surrender to Krishna's will. So both approaches are there, but at least in the Bhagavatam, there is no mention specifically that once the curse was given, whether the curse could have been withdrawn. Counter cursing could have been possible, but the curse was then accepted as the will of the Lord, the arrangement of the Lord ultimately. Okay. Okay. Any other questions or comments? Yes, please.
Thank you, Prabhu. It was a beautiful class. I have a question. It's about karma. It was a discussion I was having with Vishaka earlier yesterday, and we were a little stumped about this and thought we should ask you. Do demigods, are they under the laws of karma?
Okay. Are demigods under the laws of karma? Generally, the earth is considered to be the karma bhumi. So this is the arena where karma, in terms of action, reaction, we are under that. The devatas are generally considered to be an abode where they are simply reaping or enjoying the results of their good karma. Having said that, the devatas also in their lives go through difficulties. So those difficulties may be because of external causes, say demons attack them, and they may be because sometimes they themselves commit some mistakes. Now, if we see karma as a law for administering the world, then the principle that we are conscious agents who are responsible for our choices, that is universal. Even the devatas are responsible for their actions. If Indra disrespects Brihaspati, he gets a severe reaction for that. So if Indra does something wrong, there are many cases of Indra does something wrong and he is penalized for that. And to the point of where he is cursed to take a lower species birth also. And Indra, we could say, is the embodiment of the most powerful being in the heavenly planets. So in that sense, if we consider karma as the broad principle that we are responsible for our actions, then in that sense, karma is universal. It is present even in the higher planets, everywhere. But if you take karma as a specific system of law, where every single one of our actions is monitored, and every single one of our actions will have a reaction, then that, in that sense, the earth is primarily the arena of karma. So the word karma can be multivalent. It's just like we could say, if there is a kingdom in which there's a prison where everybody is very rigidly controlled. And there might be somebody who we could say is in house arrest. They have a nice bungalow in which they are staying. They have TV, they have internet, they can do various things. But even there, so they have relatively much more freedom to do what they want to do. But even there are limits. If they disrupt things in a big way, there are consequences. So the control in a prison would be much more, control in a house arrest would be lesser. So we could say that being in the heavenly planets is like being in house arrest in a villa. So it's so comfortable that it doesn't seem like an arrest at all. But still, one is there, even the person who is there is also under control. So the rigid sense of the law of karma in terms of every action being in which we are accountable for every single action, that I don't know, because the word karma bhumi is used for the earth generally.
But that actions have consequences that we see in the heavens also. Okay. You would like to add something, Marathi?
It seemed that your definition of karma for this planet and your definition of karma for the higher planets is really the same. Just the higher planets, they're enjoying facilities because of their piety, form of piety, whereas the Earth, we don't have those facilities or that opulence. But as far as karma here and karma in the heavenly planets, they're both experiencing actions for or reactions for their actions.
So is if in heaven and earth both are both are getting reactions for their actions, then is there any difference between karma defined here and there? Not really. I would say that what I meant is that if we consider, say, in this world, there is if somebody has, say, illicit sex, there is a severe reaction for that. But Indra has many, many apsaras over there. In the heavenly planets, there are we could say that the license of what is accepted as enjoyable, that is much greater. So in that sense, the actions which will bring karmic reactions. Basically, if you see the Bhagavatam, the Bhagavata gives the example that yatha akashasito nityam vayu sarvatra go mahan tatha sarvani bhutani matsthani ityopadharay. 9.6 it states that. That just as the mighty wind is contained within the sky, similarly all living beings are contained within my will. So basically, we can say that our actions are always free, but the area of our actions varies. Say, an ant can barely move along the ground, an eagle can swoop through the sky. So that is based on karma. An ant has very small area of control. The eagle has a much greater area of control. So in the heavens, the area, basically area of control, we could extend it to mean that it is the area in which one can control and enjoy and not get any reactions for that. So that in the heavens is much more. So of course, here also on the earth, we could say that there are kings. The kings, if they were taking responsibility, then they could have many queens and they could have much more sensual pleasure. But they had to take responsibility for that. So if we consider the heavens, that is a further extension of that principle, where by past karma, not only the facilities for enjoyment are more, in the sense of what is the resources available for enjoyment, but also the actions that are culpable, the same actions are not in the same way culpable. So here intoxication is considered culpable, but in the heavenly planets, if somebody takes soma, either to go to heavens or in heavens, that is not considered culpable. But after drinking soma, if somebody becomes intoxicated, like say Nalakur Mani Guru become intoxicated excessively, and then they disrespect Narad Muni, then Narad Muni can curse them. So it's more that the area of what can be done, that is the facility or the license is much bigger in the heavens. So yeah, in a broad sense, as you rightly said, that karma is not defined differently, karma is the same. But what actions are karmically culpable and what actions are not karmically culpable, that area is much more strictly controlled in this world and far less controlled in the heavens. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions or comments? Yes, sir. Yeah, please.
Hare Krishna, thank you for the wonderful lecture. So what I understood is, it's a valuable lesson that we see, we go much more closer to Krishna in seeing Krishna's hand or Daiva, but of course it's difficult to do, and that requires, as you rightly explained, tremendous humility. We also see that Krishnadas, Kaviraj Goswami and others, they talk about humility. So, but sometimes, you know, the humility can be superficial, and it also can be a expression of inferiority complex. So my question to you is, what is the way to develop genuine humility, which seems to be a very essential ingredient to do this transition of consciousness?
Yes. So sometimes the humility can be superficial if we try to imitate expressions of great saint like say Krishna Das Kanhaiya Goswami, or humility can actually be inferiority complex also. So how do we develop the genuine humility that is essential for devotion? Yeah, in my understanding, humility is a quality and is expressed through service attitude. So if we situate ourselves in the understanding that I am a servant of Krishna, then that itself helps us to stay humble. And in the service of Krishna, sometimes we may have to be assertive. Bhima would fight fiercely for the service of Krishna. Prabhupada himself, when the Juhu land was threatened, Prabhupada said that I will not let this Mr. N take Krishna's property ever. Steal this land from Krishna. So Prabhupada was very strong in fighting over there. So humility essentially means service attitude. So if we situate ourselves in the mood that I am a servant of Krishna, then that humility will be expressed in a way that is authentic. It is, if you know, we in a sense of humility, we might repeat, Amara jivan sada paperat nahi ko punye ralesh. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says that my life is filled with sin, there is not the slightest sense of piety in it. Now that is an exalted expression of humility, and that comes when a devotee is actually feeling the flood of Krishna's love in their heart. And then the devotee feels, what am I doing for Krishna in return? Krishna is offering so much mercy to me, I am doing nothing. So that's the logic, that is the transcendental reasoning of Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami when he says that Jagai and Madai are better than me. He says, they got the mercy of Lord Chaitanya and they immediately gave up everything and transformed themselves. But I have got the mercy of Lord Chaitanya for so long, but what have I done to reciprocate? I have done nothing. So that transcendental humility, when a devotee feels that I am completely sinful, completely fallen, I am utterly hopeless, that comes when the vision is so fixed on Krishna that in the light of Krishna's greatness, whatever goodness we have appears utterly insignificant. But when that light of Krishna's greatness is not there, we are not experiencing that, then at that time artificially expressing, oh, I am extremely fallen, well, that may not lead to any increase in our devotion. Our focus should be on serving Krishna. On serving Krishna. When Prabhupada was in Vrindavan, there's one devotee, I forget his name, this is there, I think Harishauri Prabhu's book. This is every day when Prabhupada was in Vrindavan, maybe 1975-76, he would memorize one verse from the Bhagavatam and is like, oh, you are my spiritual master, you are my savior, I am so fallen. And when Prabhupada would go in the morning walk, Prabhupada would come back from the morning walk, he would be standing there and he would recite that verse for Prabhupada. And once it happened, twice it happened. Third day, Prabhupada heard the words and Prabhupada said, do something practical. Now of course it's good to recite verses and good to offer verses, but Prabhupada probably saw the consciousness over there. And he said, I'm so, yes, I'm so learned, I'm so special, I'm offering a verse. Prabhupada said, do something practical. So, the important thing is to act in a mood of service. Do some practical service, act in the mood of a servant. And humility, if we see that our defining relationship is that I am a servant of Krishna. And then my disposition should be such that it enhances my service to Krishna. And sometimes for the service of Krishna, we may have to take a strong stand. Sometimes we may think, okay, I am the servant of Krishna, I just take a step back and let things happen the way they are happening as a service to Krishna. So,
When does when it's inferiority complexes, basically when we are centered on Krishna, then it is humility. When we are centered on ourselves, then it is not humility. So there is humility and there is humiliation. When I feel that others have insulted me, others have neglected me, others have mocked me, and I feel humiliated. So basically, I put it this way, that humility is false ego rejected. I don't want to be considered great. I just want to be a servant of Krishna. Whereas humiliation or even inferiority complex, they're similar. That is false ego frustrated. I want to be big. I want the world to know how good I am. But you know, I can't find anything good which I can earn the world's glories. So what can I do? That's why I feel inferior. So when, as long as we are self-centered, then we cannot have authentic humility. So if our humility, whatever we consider to be humility, it is just making us feel more and more sorry for ourselves, more and more feeling negative, then that is not humility. I gave a class in Canada last year. Self-pity is not humility. Feeling sorry for ourselves is not humility. It is that I want to be devoted to Krishna. And okay, if I don't have this limit, I don't have these abilities, I don't have this ability, still, I'll maintain my intention to serve Krishna and I'll serve Krishna. So if a Krishna centered in the mood of service to him, then the disposition that we have will have humility within it. Prabhupada gives that well-known definition that humility means not be anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. So he's not saying we should not be honored by others. He's not saying that if somebody honors us, it's not that we can't be satisfied also. We can see that honor as, yes, I'm doing some service and people are appreciating that service. But if that is the driving motivation, when I come to a temple, why is no one offering obeisances to me? If instead of coming to the temple to offer obeisances to Krishna, if I am worried, why is no one offering obeisances? Then that is not humility at all. That is not be anxious to have the satisfaction of being honored by others. So focus on serving Krishna. If the service to Krishna gives us some honor, we accept that as a service to Krishna. It requires that we accept dishonor. Srila Prabhupada, when he was in India, he was honored at least nominally or culturally as a sadhu. When he came from India to America, at that time nobody knew him. Just people treated him like a strange old man. When he was staying in the Lower East Side, at that time, in the early days, the devotees were staying with him. They didn't even have that any inkling of how to respect a saintly person. So in the morning when Prabhupada would wake up, they would use the restroom. Prabhupada would stand in the queue to use the restroom. So Prabhupada was just treated like an utterly ordinary person. But Prabhupada accepted that because that was required for the service of Krishna. But when Prabhupada came to India later, and the devotees had organized, by the time the movement had become very big in the 1970s, and the devotees had organized a big pandal program for him in Jaipur. And then they had advertised it as Bhaktivedanta Swami with his foreign disciples. So Prabhupada said, why foreign disciples? Yes, right, American and British disciples. So why foreign can be African, foreign can be any part of the world also. So Prabhupada, was it that he was seeking honor? No. He was saying that by this, Swami has American disciples, his British disciples, people will come for the program more by that. So Prabhupada was doing what was required for the service of Krishna. So if focus on the service of Krishna and are Krishna centered, then humility will be the disposition that will go with it. Okay? Thank you. Yes.
Hare Krishna. Paramahansa, I really liked your point about exclusive devotion and inclusive devotion. I just want some more clarification for my understanding. You know, sometimes it has happened with me. Someone offered me Hari service, Janmashtami, I grabbed it. You know, and then on the same day someone said, can you help me parking? And I said, well, I have some other services. Whereas, so one is, you know, by your definition, a service directly serving the deities, which is, you know, very much exclusive service. And the other service is, yes, serving the devotees and, you know, serving the event. But, you know, certainly not exclusive, it's inclusive. Mm. But according to me, this later was a much higher service. And many, many such examples, you know, so you invite someone to give a lecture, yes, yes, I will. But, you know, do something else. I mean,
okay.
So
I get your question. Okay, when I said if it's exclusive service and inclusive service, if somebody asks us to do pujari service or to give a class, then we feel that that is much more closely connected with Krishna. But somebody asks us to take care of parking or do some cleaning, we feel that is not connected with Krishna. We don't see it so directly connected with Krishna. So how do we redefine exclusive and inclusive? Yeah, see, in general, taxonomy, when it is translated to real world, is always problematic. Taxonomy is a system of classification. Say like, on the map of the world, you'll say, okay, this is India, this is Pakistan, this is China, this is Bangladesh. But if you go actually, there is no neat dividing line between India and China. That's why there is a conflict going on constantly also. So, any system of classification, it is conceptual. It is a conceptual tool for analyzing and dividing, analyzing. But we translate that conceptual tool into real life, there are always gray areas. So that's why we cannot literally use any conceptual tool immediately into trans. There are always shades of gray. Having said that, there is, by exclusive devotion, what I meant is that we are focused on Krishna. And is it that, say, the pujari service will help us to focus more on Krishna and the cleaning service or parking service may not help us focus on Krishna? Yes, at one level it is true. The closer we are to the deities, or what we are directly speaking about Krishna, that will help us to focus more on Krishna. But it is not just a matter of what we are doing. It is a matter of why we are doing it. So, it is, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was more pleased by Pratabhrudra cleaning the road in front of Jagannath. Now he was a king. If he had demanded, he could have been one of the persons doing aarti to Jagannath also. That is not the tradition, he would not demand that. But he did that, and that is what pleased Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So ultimately, we could say there are two aspects to it. One is that we find out consciously by what our consciousness connects with Krishna. So for some people it may be kirtan, for some people it may be deity worship, for some people it may be speaking about Krishna. That is what we, with our effort, find out what helps us to connect with Krishna. But we also have to understand that connection with Krishna is not just by our effort, it is also by Krishna's mercy. By His mercy, when He is pleased with us, He can in one moment just purge off our impurities. He can in one moment reveal His beauty within our hearts, and we'll get much more attracted to Him. Now, when that moment will come in our life, we don't know. So, in principle, we can say that we should be willing to do whatever service we are told to do. And there are certain services which may actually remind us that we are the servants. If we are always doing services that are visible and you could say devotionally glamorous. So the service of a pujari, service of a preacher, service of a kirtan leader, these are visible, everybody sees them, people admire them. If we are seeing those kind of services only, then it's possible that they may actually not create so much the mood of the servant, but create more of the mood of I'm an enjoyer, and I'm such a special person. So that may actually not lead to devotion, much devotion. I remember a senior Vaishnava told me once that when we are giving a class, sometimes the speaker may be speaking about Krishna, but the audience may make more advancement by hearing about Krishna from the speaker, then the speaker may make by speaking about Krishna. Because the audience is focused on, oh, I want to learn about Krishna. The speaker may be focused on, you know, how many people are attending my class, who is sleeping, who is appreciating me. And the audience, the speaker may be very self-conscious at that time. So that's why it's a matter of disposition. So if the situation requires us to do some particular service, we accept that service, even if that doesn't, that seems to be not so directly connected with Krishna, because that can help us to develop the mood of service. At the same time, we also have to, we depend on Krishna's mercy for that moment of magical illumination or transformation. But at the same time, we have to sustain our bhakti. And for sustaining our bhakti, we have to take responsibility. So in general, we should find out a service that we feel inspired to do, and we continue that steadily. So that way, we feel inspired to do means what? That we should be able to do that service even if nobody is there to appreciate that service. So yes, if it's Janmashtami and I have given the opportunity to do aarti, that's wonderful. But if then somebody during a weekday when there's practically nobody to even see the aarti, I am alone doing aarti, I should be ready to do that that time also. So I was asking a senior preacher that sometimes when we give a class, so the audience is not, that very little audience is there, the audience is also not interested. So how do we motivate ourselves? So he said that you should actually speak for Krishna's pleasure. By my expression, he understood that this was too high level answer. So then he said that he had asked this question to Bhakti Tirth Maharaj. And Bhakti Tirth Maharaj said that if the audience is not interested and you are speaking at that time, you should see that class as a practice for when you will be speaking in future to interested audiences. So, the point related with our discussion is that actually we have to find out that we stay motivated in the service of Krishna. So, for us to have a sustainable connection, we have to find out which service helps us to become absorbed. And we try to do that service as much as possible. But along with that, as a matter of developing a service attitude, we can do other services also. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Thank you. So, shall we? Do we have time, Sindhanthru? Yeah. So, I'll be here for a few more days. Can we continue? Can note down the question, we can discuss at that time. So thank you very much. Gantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki.
Jai.
Srila Prabhupada ki.
Jai.
Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki.
Jai.
Jai Gaur Premanande.
Jai.